together and worship our Savior. Jesus is worthy of our praise. He's worthy of our trust. You are holy.
You are holy.
You are mighty.
You are mighty.
You are worthy.
You are worthy.
Worthy of praise.
Worthy of praise.
I will follow.
I will follow.
I will listen.
I will listen.
I will love you.
I will love you.
All of my days. You are holy.
You are holy.
You are mighty.
You are worthy.
Worthy of
praise.
I will follow.
I will follow.
I will
listen.
I will love you. You are Lord of lords, you are King of kings, you are mighty God, Lord of everything. You're Emmanuel, you're the great I am, you're the Prince of Peace, who is the Lamb. You're the living God, you're my saving grace, you will reign forever, you are Ancient of Days. You are Alpha, Omega, beginning and end. You're my Savior, Messiah, Redeemer, and friend. You're my Prince of Peace, and I will live my life for you. You're my Prince of Peace, and I will live my life for you. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever breathe. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Show me who you are. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. We live for you. Is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holdeth in the bay. My anchor holdeth in. Save. when he shall come with trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. Amen. You may be seated.
If you would please turn your Bibles to the book of Acts. We continue our study of the book of Acts. We have arrived this morning at chapter 4. I will remind you, as we said last week, that chapter 4 is simply a continuation of chapter 3. I know there's a break there, a chapter break, but really there's not in the narrative. It goes right from what is happening in chapter 3 to what we read here in chapter 4. So I'm going to read chapter 4, verses 1 through 12, although we will be looking at the majority of the chapter in a minute. So keep your bookmark here, because I will be coming back. This is my text. And as I read it, I will remind you that this is the Word of God. Acts chapter 4, verse 1. As they were speaking to the people, the priest and the captain of the temple guard and the Sadducees came up to them, being greatly disturbed because they were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection from the dead. And they laid hands on them and put them in jail until the next day, for it was already evening. But many of those who had heard the message believed, and the number of the men came to be about 5,000. On the next day, their rulers and elders and scribes were gathered together in Jerusalem. And Annas, the high priest, was there, and Caiaphas, and John, and Alexander, and all who were of high priestly descent. When they had placed them in the center, they began to inquire, "By what power or in what name have you done this?" Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers and elders of the people, if we are on trial today for a benefit done to a sick man, as to how this man has been made well, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by this name, this man stands here before you in good health. He," this is speaking of Christ, Jesus, "he is the stone which was rejected by you, the builders, but which became the chief cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven that has been given among men by which we must be saved." Let's pray. Father, again, as we read the scripture, we try to put ourselves there in the action as observers. What is happening here? A notable miracle had taken place. It was an undeniable miracle. The man was standing right there. The people knew him. He was 40 years old. He had never walked. And the next thing you know, he's leaping and praising and dancing, going into the temple, praising God. And when everybody else is excited and dumbfounded and amazed, chapter 3 says, I think, amazed two or three times, they're amazed, the temple guard comes and arrests Peter and John. Why? What for? What was going on here? But Lord, Peter's sermon may have got interrupted, so he just picked up where he left off and preached it to them. And it's about Jesus, the name which we must call upon for salvation. So I pray this morning you give us a better understanding of Jesus, a greater faith in the name of Jesus. Lord, open our eyes, our hearts, our minds to understand your scripture this morning, I pray. Amen.
Children, third grade and down, are dismissed to Children's Church at this time, and let's continue in worship. Let's stand together as we sing and bless the name of the Lord.
All praise to him who reigns above in majesty supreme, who gave his son for man to die that he might man redeem. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. His name above all names shall stand, exalted more and more. At God the Father's own right hand, where angel hosts adore. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. His name shall be the Counselor, the Mighty Prince of Peace, of all earth's kingdoms conquered. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
How firm a foundation, ye saints of the Lord, is laid for your faith. It is excellent word. What more can he say than to you he hath said, to you for refuge to Jesus have fled. Fear not, I am with thee. Oh, be not dismayed, for I am your God, and will still give thee aid. I'll strengthen thee, help thee, and cause thee to stand upheld by my righteous omnipotence. When through fiery trials thy pathway shall lie, my grace all sufficient shall be thy supply. The flame shall not hurt thee, I only desire thy dross to consume and thy gold to refine. The soul that on Jesus hath leaned for repose, I will not desert to its foes. That soul, though all hell should endeavor to shake, I'll never, no, never, no, never forsake. That soul, though all hell should endeavor to shake, I'll never, no, never, no, never forsake.
Amen. You may be seated.
All right. Acts chapter 4. Up to this point in the book of Acts, there had been no resistance to the Christians on the part of the Jews. Indeed, the picture that has we have seen has been that of general acceptance and favor with the people. Look back at chapter 2, verse 47. Praising God and having favor with all the people, and the Lord was adding to their number day by day those who were being saved. In this chapter, things change. Not, however, with the people. They are still responding favorably to the message, in fact, in an overwhelming way. Look at chapter 4, verse 4. But many of those who had heard the message believed, and the number of men came to be about 5,000. So it wasn't the people that had turned against them, it was the Jewish officials who turned against them. Particularly the aristocrats who were afraid that these Christ followers would upset the status quo. You look at chapter 4, verse 1. As they were speaking to the people, the priest and the captain of the temple guard and the Sadducees came up to them. Verse 5. On the next day, their rulers and elders and scribes were gathered together in Jerusalem. And Annas the high priest was there, and Caiaphas, and John and Alexander, and all who were of high priestly descent. Now you need to know that at this time, the high priesthood was pretty much a political office. You had to have Roman permission to be it. It wasn't like it had been set up. It became a family affair. And when the one term was up, they would appoint their brother or their son to be in that office. But you'll notice that Caiaphas and John and Alexander, they were still there on this council. Verse 6. Verse 15. And when they had ordered them to leave the council, they began to confer with one another. So the council was called the Sanhedrin. It was called the Sanhedrin. This is the same council, by the way, who had arrested and tried Jesus. They were the political leaders. So we're going to look at what happened here in chapter 4. First, we're going to see the arrest. The arrest. Verse 1. As they were speaking to the people, again, so this is an interruption. It goes back to what Peter was preaching in chapter 3, starting at verse 11. This is the second sermon we have recorded that the Apostle Peter has preached thus far. But he notice it says, as they were speaking to the people. Now, we mentioned last week that it's always Peter and John. Peter was always the spokesman. But we made mention last week that the reason there were always two, and Jesus had sent them out two by two, was to be a witness. A testimony took two witnesses. So John was always there to back up what Peter was saying. If Peter says Jesus rose from the dead, John can say, I saw it too, okay? But here we see that as they were speaking to the people, so it isn't that it was only Peter who was speaking. John was also speaking in support. But as they were speaking, they got interrupted. Now, you'll see in verse 1 that it was the priest and the captain of the temple guard and the Sadducees. It's important to know that these were Sadducees. Look at chapter 5, verse 17. But the high priest rose up along with all his associates, that is, the sect of the Sadducees, and they were filled with jealousy. Look at chapter 23, Acts 23, verse 6. We're going to find out what this particular sect of the Sadducees believed or didn't believe. Acts 23, verse 6. But perceiving that one group were Sadducees and the other Pharisees, Paul began crying out in the council, "Brethren, I am a Pharisee, a son of Pharisees. I am on trial for the hope and the resurrection of the dead." Being Sadducees, their issue here was with the idea of resurrection. They did not believe in the resurrection of the dead. Now, if you grew up in Sunday school, right, you learned how to remember Sadducees. They were Sadducee because they didn't believe in the resurrection of the dead, right? So when you see Sadducees mentioned, it's important because they did not believe that miracles were possible, and they did not believe that resurrection was possible. And when Paul, when he was being tried by the council, he picked up on the division because there were some Pharisees who did take the Bible literally and Sadducees who ignored most of the Old Testament. He said, "Hey, I'm on trial because of the resurrection." And they got in a big argument with each other about the resurrection because that's what the sect of the Sadducees was known for. And lo and behold, we go back to chapter 4 and we see here in verse 1 and 2 that that's what's going on. In fact, look at verse 2. Being greatly disturbed because they were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection from the dead. Now, this is the wording here is very significant. Their issue with them was with the concept of resurrection. The problem was not that they were proclaiming the resurrection of Jesus, but proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection from the dead. Again, look at verse 2. Being greatly disturbed because they were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus, what? The resurrection from the dead. That's why they were upset. They did not believe in the resurrection from the dead. And this sermon that Peter was preaching alarmed them because he's preaching about resurrection. He called Jesus the author of life, whom they knew had died. They had crucified him. And since they didn't believe in the resurrection, they're not going to believe Jesus was risen. And he also called Jesus a new Moses. These were revolutionary ideas. And to the powers that be, the council, the Sanhedrin, this had to be stopped. This movement must be stopped here and now. They did not want it gaining popularity. Of course, verse 4 tells us that there was a problem. It was gaining popularity with the people. So they interrupt the sermon. They arrest them, and verse 3, and they laid hands on them and put them in jail until the next day, for it was already evening. So when Peter and John went to the temple, it was the ninth hour, and with all, everything going on, it's now night. So they are put in a holding cell until they could have a hearing the next day. So that is the arrest. What were the charges? Well, look at verse 5. On the next day, their rulers and elders and scribes were gathered together in Jerusalem. And Annas the high priest was there, and Caiaphas and John and Alexander, and all who were of high priestly descent. Who was not there, of course, were the Romans. There were no Roman officials involved in this. This was a Jewish matter. The Roman authorities getting involved was what they were trying to avoid. They did not want this messianic movement to catch fire. They did not want this messianic movement to proceed unchecked because the Romans would then get involved. The Romans allowed the Jews a certain amount of independence, and they could make some of their own rules and do some of their own things. But again, if the Romans began to notice, wait a minute, there's this messianic movement taking place, then they would step in. So this council, the Sanhedrin, were worried about law and order, about keeping the peace. So verse 7 says, When they had placed them in the center, so the Sanhedrin is kind of like in a semicircle, and they put Peter and John there on the witness stand, if you will, they began to inquire, by what power or by what name have you done this? In other words, they want to say, they were asking them, by what authority? When you say name, it means authority. What name? What authority? By what authority are you doing this? In other words, do you have the proper accreditation to go around teaching this kind of stuff? Did we approve this? They were afraid that, again, this major messianic insurrection would have serious political fallout. But you notice verse 7 at the end, it says, have you done this? A conveniently vague reference to an extraordinary miracle. The this was the healing of a man who had never walked before. But they didn't want to bring that up. They said, by what authority have you done this? Forget what happened here. They'd like to ignore that, although we'll see that they can't. But they said, by what authority are you teaching the people? Why are you doing this? Well, Peter would not let them hide behind this ambiguity. Verses 8 and 9. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers and elders of the people, if we're on trial today for a benefit done to a sick man as to how this man has been made well, okay, instead of giving a defense, Peter gives them a sermon. Luke 12:11. When they bring you before the synagogues and the rulers and the authorities, do not worry about how or what you will are to speak in your defense or what you are to say, for the Holy Spirit will teach you in that very hour what you ought to say. So this is what's going on here. Peter doesn't even give a defense. He just continues his sermon to a captive audience, right? They're supposed to be the captives, but the Sanhedrin's the ones that are captive right now. Peter begins to preach them a sermon. And, they'd said this, but they didn't want to describe it. So he says, well, verse 9, if we're on trial today for the benefit done to the sick man, then this is how it happened. All right, he won't let them ignore that. And what he tells us here is, verses 10 through 12, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus the Nazarene, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, again, there's that problem. They're teaching resurrection. By this name, this man stands here before you in good health. He is the stone, Jesus, is the stone which was rejected by you, quoting Scripture, the builders, but which became the chief cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven that has been given among men by which we must be saved. What Peter is saying here is, hey, it's not about the healing, it's about the salvation. It's not about the healing, it's about the salvation. That phrase in verse 9, has been made well, is the same word in Greek in verse 12, that says saved. He says, yes, this man was physically saved, but more importantly, we all need to be saved. Now, if you don't truly believe verses 10, 11, and 12, if you don't believe that there's only one name under heaven whereby we must be saved, right? If you don't believe that Jesus actually was crucified, died, buried, and rose again the third day. If you don't really believe that, you will never be willing to go to jail for it. In fact, we'll see shortly, it doesn't end in jail. They died for it. They were martyred for it. But if you don't really believe it, if you read verse 12, but deep down you don't really believe that, you'll never go to jail for it. You wouldn't be willing to. What's the verdict? Verse 13. Now, as they observed the confidence of Peter and John and understood that they were uneducated and untrained men, they were amazed and began to recognize them of having to be with Jesus. And seeing the man who had been healed standing with them, they had nothing to say in reply. So they had heard Peter's testimony, And now it was time for the jury to deliberate. They had assessed the evidence. Now notice what they say here. When they noticed Peter's courage and freedom in which he spoke, they were shocked because, again, when we read this, we think they were uneducated and untrained men. We think more of, you know, reading and writing and arithmetic. That's not what they're talking about. Okay, they weren't trained theologians. They weren't of the rabbinical school. They weren't Pharisees or Sadducees. They weren't scribes. In that respect, they were unlearned and untrained men. I think the King just says ignorant. But no, that Peter and John said, we don't need that training, because it goes on to say, verse 13, and began to recognize them as having been with Jesus. So as they are looking at Peter and John, they'd seen them before. They had been followers of Jesus. So the fact that they had been with Jesus, however, in their eyes, didn't help their case. It didn't give them authority, but became a threat to their power. I mean, that's why they had Jesus crucified. They couldn't do it. The Romans had to do it. But they accused him of treason before Pilate. They were afraid of this, of him being the Messiah and wresting power from them. So when they recognized he was with Jesus, again, their worst fears are coming true. Even though we killed this man or had him killed, there's still a movement being born here, and that was a threat to their power. Now, the last piece of that is, of course, verse 15. But when they had ordered them to leave the council, they began to confer with one another, saying, what shall we do with these men? For the fact that a noteworthy miracle has taken place through them is apparent to all who live in Jerusalem, and we cannot deny it. So standing beside them is Exhibit A, the man who had been healed. So that puts them in a quandary. What exactly are we going to tell the people we're accusing these men of when everybody with their own eyes saw this miracle? What are we going to do here? Warren Wiersbe said, the council did not seek for truth, but rather sought for some way to avoid the truth. Fact is, the guilty parties here were the Jewish authorities. They were the ones who were guilty. They're trying to deny the truth. Verse 17. But so that it will not spread any further among the people, this was their conclusion, this was their verdict, let us warn them to speak no longer to any man in this name. And when they had summoned them, they commanded them not to speak or teach in the name of Jesus. See, this was not a clear-cut case. They really had no charge against them. You can't charge somebody for healing a man, right? What are they charging them with? The fact that they were teaching the resurrection of the dead and the Sadducees didn't believe in the resurrection of the dead? The people are not going to buy that. So they're between a rock and a hard place. All they could do was threaten. Well, verse 19. But Peter and John answered and said to them, whether it is right in the sight of God to give heed to you rather than God, you be the judge. Again, they were trying to be the judge, right? All right, he says, go ahead and be the judge. Should we obey God or you? For we cannot stop speaking about what we have seen and heard. And when they threatened them further, they let them go, finding no basis on which to punish them, because they had broken no law. On account of the people, because they were all glorifying God for what has happened. Again, what's the Sanhedrin going to do? The people saw it, and they're glorifying God. Are they supposed to come out and say, don't glorify God? Oh, that's what they wanted. They didn't want to glorify God. They wanted to glorify them, right? Verse 22, for the man was more than 40 years old whom the miracle had been performed. Well, what was the result? So they're tried, they're warned, they're threatened, they're released. What happened? Verse 23, when they had been released, they went to their own companions. Now, in the New American Standard Version, you'll notice the companions is italicized. That's the way of the translator saying, we've put that word in there to help you better understand it. But it actually says they went to their own. They went to their own. Their own was their own people, the church, the congregation. It wasn't just the apostles. They went to their own people. So verse 23, when they had been released, they went to their own companions and reported all that the chief priest and the elders had said to them. And when they heard this, they lifted their voice to God with one accord and said, O Lord, it is you who made the heaven and the earth and the sea and all that is in them. Notice that they were with one accord. Persecution makes you appreciate the church more. They'd been threatened. They went immediately to the church, to their own, told them what happened. They needed the other people's prayers and supports. And this persecution, this threat of persecution, created unity. They were all in one accord. But what is amazing here is their prayer, verse 25. By whom the Holy Spirit, through the mouth of our father David, your servant, said, why do the Gentiles rage and the peoples devise futile things? The kings of the earth took their stand, and the rulers were gathered against them, against the Lord and against his Christ. For truly in this city they are gathered together against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, along with the Gentiles and the people of Israel. Everything they said in that prayer was shaped by what God had said to them in Scripture. Everything they said to God in that prayer was shaped by what God had said to them in Scripture. You'll notice it's quotes. They quoted Psalm 2, chapter 2, verse 1. They quoted Psalm 146, verse 6. They quoted Psalm chapter 2, verse 2. They're praying Scripture. Persecution teaches you to pray better. They went to the Scripture. And they took what was said in the Old Testament and they applied it to Christ, to the New Testament. So in verse 25, it says, why did the Gentiles rage? In verse 27, it says, for truly in this city they were gathered together against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, along with the Gentiles. So they found the Gentiles that were mentioned in verse 25 and Psalm 2:2 are the Gentiles that are mentioned in verse 27. The peoples, and the peoples devise futile things in chapter and verse 25. Again, they mentioned, and truly in this city, verse 27, they were gathered together against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, along with the Gentiles and the peoples of Israel. They're saying, Lord, you told us this in Scripture. We have seen it come to pass. Verse 26, and the kings of the earth took their stand. And verse 27, the kings of the earth are Herod and Pontius Pilate. This bizarre alliance gathered together in verse 26, and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ. In verse 27, truly in this city we're gathered together against, verse 26, his Christ, and in verse 27, that is Jesus. But notice verse 28. To do whatever your hand and your purpose predestined to occur. In other words, all the plotting against God's anointed is in vain because God has already predetermined the outcome. The Gentiles, the peoples, the kings, this bizarre alliance, doesn't matter. Because God, verse 28, will do whatever your hand and your purpose predestined to occur. And we've seen this before. Chapter 2, verse 23. Acts 2, 23. This man delivered over by the predetermined plan and foreknowledge of God, you nailed to the cross by hands of godless men and put him to death. We see it again in chapter 3, verse 18. But the things which God announced beforehand by the mouth of all of his prophets that his Christ would suffer, he has thus fulfilled. Persecution pushes you to trust in God's sovereignty. So they threatened them. They arrested them. They jailed them. What was the result? It was not what they intended the result to be. Their intended result was that they'd shut up. Right? But instead, they made them appreciate the believers more and went for the others' support and prayers. It created unity among the church. It drove them to pray. It drove them to trust God's sovereignty. God's purposes will prevail. So here's the most amazing thing, verse 29. And now, Lord, take note of their threats and grant. Now, stop right there. Okay? In the average prayer meeting, the next phrase would be stop the persecution. Right? Lord, please stop the persecution. Lord, please don't allow us to go to jail. Is that what they said? Verse 29, and now, Lord, take note of their threats and grant that your bondservants may speak your word with all confidence. They didn't pray for deliverance. They prayed for boldness. They didn't pray, Lord, please make it stop. Lord, please make it stop. No, just the opposite. Verse 30, while you extend your hand to heal and signs and wonders take place through the name of your holy servant Jesus. And when they had prayed, the place where they had gathered together was shaken. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak the word of God with boldness. Their prayer was answered. But I do want you to notice something here. Notice that the filling of the Spirit did not result in tongues talking, but in speaking the word of God. Okay. Now, this is similar to Pentecost, and that they were all filled with the Spirit, and it's dissimilar to Pentecost. There was no tongue talking. They were filled with the Spirit, and it gave them boldness to speak what? The word of God, their own tongue. So here they were jailed, threatened, but no physical harm. In the next chapter, they will be jailed, punished, and threatened further. In chapter 6 and 7, we have the martyrs. Beginning with Stephen the deacon, will be martyred for his faith, and then James the apostle will be martyred for his faith. Well, let me close with this. The real question isn't, would you be willing to spend a night in jail for Jesus? But the real question is, how many nights would you be willing to spend in jail for Jesus? Let's pray. Now, Lord, as I was reading this week, and I was seeing that their problem wasn't so much with that they were preaching Jesus, it's that they were preaching what came along with Jesus. They were preaching resurrection, and the powers that be didn't believe in resurrection. So the irony here is they weren't necessarily persecuted because they were Christians per se. They were persecuted because they taught what Christianity believes. And Lord, I see that developing today. It's not that we are Christians. It's not that we believe in Jesus. The problem is, because we believe in Jesus, we believe that marriage is between a man and a woman. They'd be glad to say, oh, you go ahead and believe in Jesus. Just don't say that. Or that God created us man and woman in his image. Just don't say that. Yeah, you go ahead and have your little worship service, that's fine. But don't take it out in the streets and you know, say, hey, you know, the Bible says men ought not to wear women's clothing. No, you can't say that. So, Lord, I don't know what awaits the church and in our culture, but I do wonder if we really believe what we're saying, because we may have to prove it. I pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand together as we sing in response.
Our Father everlasting, the all-creating one, God Almighty. Through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again, for I believe in the name of Jesus. Our judge and our defender suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light. Forever seated high. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe. I believe in life eternal. I believe in the virgin birth. I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son,
I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
Community Bible Church family, thank you for all your cards, messages, and mostly your prayers during my recent surgery and hospital stay. I am truly blessed to be a part of this church family. I am doing extremely well and getting more movement every day. Thank you again, and God bless every one of you. Jeff Tillett, Sr. Last Sunday morning, we announced that Carter, seven-year-old young man, had just been taken to the hospital with an infection. Carter remains in the hospital. They're still trying to determine the best way to treat this infection. If you're not on the church email chain, I posted an update on the bulletin board that you can go get where things stood yesterday, and I will, again, keep you posted. Let's pray for Carter. Now, Lord, we do pray for Carter. Lord, he's been through a lot, and we pray that you would help those in charge of his care to determine the right course of action and that he could come home soon. Lord, be with his parents, be with Josh and Sarah, be with his siblings, Lord, be with his cousins, his grandparents. Lord, I just pray you'd give them all strength and grace and peace. And Lord, we're glad for doctors, hospitals, medication, all that stuff, but you're the great physician. So we are thankful that you are on the case, God, and may your will be done. Amen. Unto the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only wise God, be glory forever and ever. And all God's people said, Amen.